topic that's interested people for a very long time, mullein can really take over the landscape. It's a pretty plant. The seeds were used as a fish poison. So if you want to go fishing and you're a little lazy to do a little casting of your line, you throw the seeds in the water and the fish float to the surface. But there's a whole bunch of other uses, medicinal uses for mullein, both for man and beast. A lot of treatments of bronchial diseases. I love common names. And when I see the common names of this on the right-hand side, candlewick, because the mid-vein of the leaf was used in oil lamps as a wick. Flannel leaf, if you've ever touched mullein, you know that it's got a very fuzzy leaf. Lungwort, because it treated lung diseases. Torchwort, because Roman soldiers used to use the dried old stalk of the mullein. They'd dip it in tallow and they'd use it for torches. Hag's taper, because it was associated with witches and it was also associated with spells against witches. And Quaker rouge, my favorite one. The Quaker women were not supposed to wear makeup. So before their sweetie came over, they would take a mullein leaf and they would just rub their cheeks a little bit. And the problem is that mullein often causes a little dermatitis. So you would get this little irritation red, but it looked like rouge, and they looked lovely for their sweeties. Okay. Some wildflower books will tell you that yarrow, top left, and lamb's quarters, the other top, and self-heal on the bottom left. I have trouble with left and right. I do north and south really easily. And nettle are alien. But that's a real good question. My oldest daughter is an archaeologist, and the lamb's quarters, the top right plant, she was looking at plant material that was included in digs from 1,000 and 2,000 years ago, and they had lamb's quarters in there. So if it is an alien plant, it did not come over after Columbus. Maybe it came across the top of the world with the people who came across the top of the world. Maybe it's a circumpolar plant and it was here anyhow. It's related to quinoa, and it's easy to grow, and it has seeds that don't have to be treated at all before they're used. Nettle in the bottom right corner has a fiber. There are medicinal and edible properties to nettle, but it has a fiber in it. And Native American women would walk around with dried nettle stems, which they would rub against their thighs to release the fiber from the rest of the stem. And the fiber could be woven into a material that was almost like linen. And when you see a picture of those Conestoga wagons going across the West, almost all of those tops of the Conestoga wagons were made out of nettle fiber. And it was also used to make tents and some other things. So really, really important plant. So the moral of the story, as I said, is not how well you remember tonight's jumble of information, but do your own homework. The top plant in the middle there is water hemlock. It's the most poisonous plant in the hemisphere. If you eat any of it, you have got 30 minutes to live. So get your affairs in order. Okay, but it is in the same family as Queen Anne's lace and caraway and fennel and anise. And when you look at the seed heads, it looks like caraway and fennel and anise. So if you're browsing, know what you're putting in your mouth before you put it in your mouth. The purple nightshade, which is the other plant, is another good example of plants that are in a family that has some really edible stuff in it and some really poisonous stuff in it. Purple nightshade is not good for you, but tomatoes and potatoes are in the same family, and they are. So we're going to cruise through some of the major plant communities around here and see what was growing in them and how they were used. The people who came over here, the first settlers, the first pilgrims and Puritans, were by and large city people. They were not farmers, which made it twice as hard for them to make a living once they got here. And they had never seen anything like the forests that they saw as soon as they landed in New England or in the mid-Atlantic. They were terrified by these forests. Often they would find some of the berry crops, which, you know, we all love to come across wild strawberries or wild blueberries or something like that. And they would say, well, you know, this is my lucky day, I found a big bunch of blueberries. There are a whole bunch of berry crops that need to have open sunlight. They don't grow underneath the trees. And the Native Americans worked hard, either with fire or with girdling trees, to keep those patches of blueberries and strawberries and raspberries open. Not only are they good to eat, but a lot of these had medicinal uses too. Strawberry was used in to assist in childbirth, and it also has a chemical in it which is good for dissolving tartar. So if you want to help keep your teeth healthy, eat a lot of strawberries. Blueberries, in almost every journal that I look at, blueberries are credited with helping to control diabetes. And they talk about blueberry tea, but also the blueberries themselves. And a lot of these fruits were eaten fresh, but a lot of them were also dried and turned into loaves, concentrated loaves of fruit, which were kind of equivalent to tomato paste when it comes to, you know, boiling something down. And a lot of them were pounded into pemmican, which was a combination of fruit and meat and, you know, dried meat and fats. But with the blueberries and diabetes, whether it was blueberry tea made from the leaves, and it's kind of dangerous to just grab any member of the blueberry family and make tea from the leaves because some of them are not good for you. When we have blueberry tea these days, we expect it to taste like blueberries, and I'm not sure that the blueberry leaf tea that they used 400 years ago did. But whether it was the fruit or the leaf tea or both, but all these books say that it was good for diabetes. Some more forest plants. Up on the top left, we have mandrake or mayapple, what the kids call umbrella plants. And it has to have two leaves coming out the top before it's mature enough to have a flower and a fruit. So the fruit is in the middle, and the fruit, it was called citron fruit sometimes because it's a very mildly lemony flavor. Medicinally, it was used for a gynecological medicine, and it is still the source of that gynecological medicine today. One of my favorite stories that I found out when I've been researching this stuff is when DeWitt Clinton, who you all remember from high school, is the guy who was the governor of New York when the Erie Canal was built. When he was pitching the Erie Canal to his investors, increased commerce in mayapple was one of the things that he put in the plus column for building the Erie Canal. So apparently it was a very popular fruit on the frontier. People used to make pies and tarts with it. It's as I say, it's kind of tasteless. It's a little bit lemony. But the plant itself was also used, as it says underneath the picture there. The potato is a New World plant. The potato traveled to the Old World, and then it traveled back to New England, where mayapple was used as a pesticide to keep the pests off of the potatoes. It was called the Irish potato by then. Top right corner is bloodroot, which has a red juice inside of it, which also causes dermatitis, but it was the Menominee word for bloodroot is to make the gourd red. So it was used as a dye for baskets and gourds. One of the answers to the questions, the teaching question that was posed at the start, is the doctrine of signature, as you can see in the bottom left-hand side. That plant is liverwort. And according to the doctrine of signature, which is an idea that is not just American, it's an idea that is around the world, if a plant looks like your liver, then it's good for your liver. If it looks like your heart, then it's good for your heart. If it's got a succulent stem, then it's good for your skin. Etc., etc. Maidenhair fern was used as a treatment for scalp and hair disorders because it has that long black midrib in the fern leaflet. So, doctrine of signature. Back in 1880, this thing reached its peak because obviously hepatica, which is one of our spring ephemerals, was used as a treatment for liver diseases. And everybody agreed that it wasn't a very effective treatment. But it continued to be used as a liver treatment, and I think that it was close to A 500,000 pounds of hepatica leaves were harvested in 1880 alone to treat ineffectually liver diseases, and it's something that was driven by the then equivalent of Big Pharma. The guys in the medicine wagon said, this is good for you, so man, they kept doing it. So that's one of your answers already. And the bottom one is wild ginger, bottom right, and wild ginger smells a little bit gingery. It's not the culinary ginger, though. But it has some antibiotic properties, and so a lot of Native Americans would throw it into the pot whenever they were cooking any meat that was a little bit iffy. And they would also take it on the war trail with them to protect against sorcery. And I suspect getting a bad case of food poisoning on the war trail was a good definition of sorcery. It kind of incapacitated you for a while, so they just were proactive about that. Bedstraw, top right, is in the same family as coffee and was used as a coffee substitute, but it was also used as a freckle remover and a diuretic. Daisy fleabane on the bottom right-hand side, the dried flowers of daisy fleabane were taken as a snuff. If you had a really, really thick head cold, then you used the daisy fleabane snuff, and that helped you sneeze out some of the stuff that was in your sinuses. And the wild columbine in the bottom middle, interesting plant. It had some medicinal uses, but I'm more interested in the fact that it was had some magical uses, too. Young men used to take the seeds of it and rub the seeds on their hands, and then they would go up and shake hands with a young woman that they wanted to woo. And it was supposed to persuade her about his virtues. And as a result, a lot of young women stayed away from a lot of young men during certain seasons of the year when they were wooing their young women. And another one was if you took the seeds of wild columbine and you put them in the pipes that were smoked at ceremonies, it was very persuasive, and you could turn somebody around to your point of view if you used those seeds. So, you know, we laugh. What do we know? We have lucky things, too. You know, athletes who wear the same underwear for 6 games in a row, whatever it is. We have, yeah. Okay, pretend I didn't say that. Okay, so some of the trees in the forest, elm bark was used as medicinally, but also there's a elm called slippery elm or red elm, and some people call it piss elm. Some people say it smells like licorice, and some people say it doesn't. But an alternative when you're making maple syrup to cooking and cooking and cooking and cooking the maple syrup, which was very difficult for the Native Americans to do before the Europeans got here with metal pots. If you were there here before that, you were using birch bark pots and you were heating up stones and you were putting the sap in these birch bark pots and you were dumping a hot stone in there and then that would heat up the sap. And doing that over and over and over and over and over again, you know, when you're cooking sap into syrup, it takes 40 gallons of sap to make 1 gallon of syrup. So that's a lot of hot rocks in birch bark vessels. So they were real happy to see those metal pots get here. But they also made, using slippery elm, they also made these gigantic vats for maple syrup. They would collect it in smaller buckets made out of elm bark, but they would put the sap into these 200-gallon big flat vats. And if you have this big flat vat of maple sap, and you let it sit overnight and it freezes, you take off the ice in the morning. And then the next day it freezes again, or the next night, and you take off the ice again. You're doing the same thing as you would be doing with boiling it. Of course, you had to keep the kids and the dogs and the flies and things like that out of it, but it gets better. So that was one used for the elm. Leather wood is the plant in the middle, top and bottom, and that's a little shrub that grows in nice, rich woodlands. Dermatitis, again. It has a really nice, strong bark, and they used to have contests to see if the strong men could pull the bark at each end and actually pull it apart, and mostly they could not. But it was also used to weave baskets, and again, some people get dermatitis from the sap. Basswood on the right, top and bottom. Almost all the twine on the frontier was made out of the soft inner bark of basswood, and it also had medicinal and edible properties including sort of tranquilizer properties. And the bottom left-hand plant is Amelanchier or shadbush or Juneberry. And that serviceberry is another name for it. That was a really, really, really important plant on the frontier and a major ingredient of pemmican. And I'll tell you really quickly why it's called serviceberry. Back in the day when there were circuit riding preachers who went from settlement to settlement, during the wintertime they couldn't get back into the settlements. But about the time that this plant is in bloom was the time that the ice was breaking up and the preachers were able to get back into some of the mountain settlements to marry people or bury people or do whatever services needed to be done. So the blooming of the plant was associated with the arrival of the preacher. More trees, oak trees on the left, top and bottom. Red oak, the red oak, black oak, oak bunch, you can always tell because the ends of the lobes are pointed. Mm-hmm. And the white oak group, you can tell because the ends of the lobes are rounded. They both have acorns. The acorns were used for food. If you are looking for something you can use right away, then you use the white oak. If you, the black oak and red oak acorns were kind of bitter and they had to be boiled and a little bit of lye ashes were put in there to kind of calm them down a little bit. Hickory also was used as a food plant, and amazingly, shagbark hickory makes a pretty nice maple, a pretty nice syrup. I was reading a Wisconsin magazine not long ago, and they were talking about cooking the twigs, I think it was, but the one I read about talked about tapping the actual tree. And those were very, very, very important plants in construction. We have beech on the top right, and that was a very important food plant, both for man and wildlife, really high in protein nut. And ash trees in the middle on the bottom. It's amazing to me that, again, there was this superstition about ash trees that wasn't just in this country. It was for a long time, and it was in other parts of the world. Scottish women had their cradles made with ash runners so snakes wouldn't crawl over up the cradle and get into the baby's cradle. Now, I'm not even sure what the snake situation is in Scotland. I know that there's nothing poisonous there. And apparently back in the days of Pliny, back, you know, a couple thousand years ago and beyond, the belief was that ash could protect you from snakes. So, this is a tree that was sacred to a number of different Native American tribes. I always figure when I'm doing a PowerPoint that you're intelligent enough to read it yourself. So, okay. It's like the bison. We had bison here in Wisconsin. Bison ranged all the way to the Atlantic. And when they killed a bison, they used everything, from the hoofs to the horns to the tail, everything. The Indians were the ones who figured out how to turn maple sap into maple syrup and beyond into maple sugar. And it not only was it a sweet treat on a landscape that didn't have a lot of sweets on it, but it was a really good trade item. I live near Newburgh, and there was a big sugar bush not far away from where I live. The Highway 33 was actually a very important trading route for the Menominee and the other tribes that were in this area. And I read one old journal that said that the people who settled here were happy to have the maple syrup and the maple sugar, but they wished that the Indians would not use the same pots that they boiled the fish in. So, yeah. So now we're going to head for the wetlands. Wars were fought about wetlands, and this is why. On the far left, we have spatterdock lily, bullhead lily, yellow water lily, and underneath that is the root or rhizome of it. And I want you to picture this, women. At this time of year, if you were a Native American and you lived near a wetland, you would be walking through a wetland in the water with bare feet, using your toes to find the roots of these yellow water lilies. And when you found one underwater with your toes, you would wiggle it out with your toes and you would throw it into a special canoe that you're trailing behind you. It had low sides, and you have a little rope over your shoulder, and these roots are as big as your arm. And they used them for all the things that we use potatoes for. And I read one account where someone was traveling in the Ohio River Valley and observing the Miami Indians, and said that they put it in a pit fire underground, and they cooked it for four days, and it tasted like mutton, which I'm not sure is a good thing or not. But as far as cattails are concerned, there's something edible on the cattail root 12 months out of the year. There's the cattail leaves themselves, which were used for weaving sides for summer dwellings and floors and all kinds of other things, baskets. And then when the Europeans got here, they were used for caning chairs. Mm-hmm. I went to school at Cornell, and at the north end of Cornell is Montezuma Wildlife Refuge, and it's a big wetland, and that was a really big chair caning area. Besides that, the flowers of the cattail, the male flower and the female flower, are on the same stalk. The pollen, the male pollen, is very yellow, and it's used as a flour substitute. It's got a lot of protein in it. It makes a really good pancake. I've had it half and half with regular flour. And the female flour was cooked like corn on the cob. So, and also some of the Midwestern tribes here, when a baby was born in the wintertime, they would take the fluff and put it into a basket, and they would put the new baby into the basket, because it was a nice warm place to lay a baby. So the eupatoriums are really, really, really important. There's a eupatorium which is poisonous. It's called white snake root. And if you've heard of Abraham Lincoln's mother, she died of something called milk sickness. And milk sickness was a sickness that the cows got when they grazed on white snake root, which is one of the eupatoriums. The calves get the tremors when they nurse, and it kills people sometimes. But these two were really, really, really important medicines on the frontier. Unfortunately, the Joe Pye weed on the right was used as a spring tonic, and apparently it tastes just awful. And strong men used to run away when their wives came at them with a spoonful of this good spring tonic. But both of them were used for some of the really serious problems. There was no malaria in this country until the English brought it over. So it treated the symptoms of malaria, the agues, the shaking fevers. They used it to treat yellow fever and typhus and typhoid. Yeah, it was just really, really important plant. Interestingly enough, when my mother was with Dad, who was stationed in Miami during World War II, she got sick, and the doctor said, gee, if we hadn't eradicated dengue fever, I would say that you had dengue fever. But dengue fever may have been eradicated, but with climate change, the mosquitoes that carry it are able to survive farther north, and dengue fever is going to probably make a comeback. And boneset, which is the plant on the left, was called boneset because it treated the symptoms of break bone fever. It's got a fever that's so bad you just feel like your bones are breaking. But that was dengue fever, and so remember that plant. More wetland plants, jewelweed on the top left and middle. That has a really succulent stem, and the succulent stem has got some antifungal qualities to it and can be used for athlete's foot or other things like that. Mosquito bites, poison ivy. There's an old saying, God put the cure where she put the disease. So if you're out in the bog and getting bitten by mosquitoes, you can use the juice from a jewelweed plant. The middle picture shows a young fruit of that plant. When the fruits get bigger, you can see the seeds are brown inside. Touch me not is another name for jewelweed, and it's called touch me not because when you pinch the bottom of that fruit, it explodes and sends the seeds away from the plant. But if you can catch the brown seeds and eat them, they're really nut-like in flavor. Yellow lady slipper, that blows me away. It was used to treat a large variety of what they called nervous disorders. Insomnia, epilepsy, nerves of various kinds. And apparently it was a medicine that didn't have any side effects. And the other thing it was used for was the powdered root was used to treat toothaches. And apparently some of these roots of these lady slipper orchids were so strong that they practically extracted the tooth during the treatment, but it really numbed up the area. The top plant on the right is great lobelia. nice, likes to have its feet kind of moist. Its scientific name is Lobelia syphilitica. Now, the first case of syphilis was recorded in Europe in 1493. And if that suggests something to you, you're right. Apparently, low-grade syphilis was endemic in some of the populations of Native Americans here. And when the Europeans came over, they picked it up, and it was kind of like revenge for smallpox. When it got over to Europe, it absolutely raged through Europe. It reached China in 10 years. The crowned heads of Europe were being wiped out by the disease. Great lobelia is one of the plants that the Native Americans used to treat the very mild symptoms that they experienced here. They didn't know anything about systemic medicine, but they treated symptoms. And they was brought over to the old world and did nothing for syphilis as it was being experienced over there. The bottom right is swamp milkweed. Again, milkweed is an important fiber plant, but this was also the Meskwaki or Fox Indians that lived in this area. Used this plant, it was guaranteed to get rid of all of your internal parasites in 1 hour. Wild rose, used for a hay fever, mainly for eye problems, especially for like the runny eyes you get with hay fever, and a number of other medicinal uses, but the rose hips are, if you take 3 wild rose hips, they have as much vitamin C in them as an orange. You have to be really careful because the rose hips are bristly, and you do not want to consume the bristles because they will irritate your intestinal tract. So if you're ever going to try one of these things, be sure to rub all the bristles off. And if you buy them commercially, just kind of check that. Arrowhead on the right-hand side has a very edible tuber, which is also called duck potato, as important food. Gold thread was another eye treatment, and it's just a little plant. It's only a few inches tall, and the reason for that quote is if you were going to collect gold thread to sell it, it actually has gold roots, but you're sitting in a wetland with mosquitoes all around on a hot day, and I can't imagine how many gold thread roots would take to make a pound. Many, 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 many. We're out in the bog now. Sundew on the top left was another freckle remover. And it was also used like bed straw was used as a thickener for curdling milk into cheese. It's a vegetarian milk curdler. The normal milk curdler is made out of a beef product. So freckles, yes. In the middle, we have pitcher plant, the flower on top, and the pitchers underneath. Pitcher plant's genus is Sarracenia, and it was named after Dr. Sarrazin in Montreal, who used the plant to treat people who had smallpox. And he swore that people had a shorter disease and fewer smallpox scars when they used pitcher plants. It was also used to collect berries. The little pitcher was used to collect berries in. And there were some charms for it, too. Cranberry, on the upper right, that is the basis of our whole commercial cranberry crop, is that little wild cranberry. And the bottom right is sphagnum moss. And sphagnum moss, when it's dry, can absorb 20 times its weight in liquid. So it was liquid, it was Pampers. Mm-hmm. They used to put it into the cradle boards when they packed the babies in there. And it was also feminine hygiene products. It's antibacterial, so that helped with the cradle boards, it helped with the diaper rash. Poison sumac, the guy on the upper right. Counter irritant, as far as I can see, means that it's something that takes your mind off your original condition. So, like if your toe hurts, poke yourself in the arm and you won't feel your toe. So at any rate, the idea of rubbing poison sumac sap on somebody who was paralyzed and thinking that it was curing them somehow because they were twitching. This is Victorian medicine. Glad I'm not there. It also, interestingly, made a permanent black ink, And it was also used as a bootblack in shoe factories, except that the people who worked with it were always coming down with poison sumac, mm-hmm. because like 85% of the population gets it. If you get poison ivy, you'll get poison sumac, and even a little bit more so. It's the same oil. On the top left, we have tamarack, medicinal and edible uses, but it was also used, the rootlets were used for sewing. So you've heard the expression, it takes a village. Well, it takes a village to make a canoe, because the bark, the outer covering, it was usually bark, sometimes elm. The outer covering was birch. The skeleton of it was cedar, which is the next one down. The thread that was used to sew everything together was tamarack rootlets. And the caulk, to keep make sure it didn't leak, was spruce tar. So that's four trees to make a single product there. So cedar, again, cedar had some edible and medicinal properties. One of the more interesting ones, that it was the cedar charcoal was used in a tattoo. And Native Americans used tattoos as sort of a charm. If you have arthritis in your elbow, you get a little tattoo there. And not only is it supposed to relieve the symptoms, but it also is supposed to keep the arthritis from returning. Does it work? I don't know. Maybe so. Maybe we're missing out on a good bet here. And willow down at the bottom right-hand side is aspirin on the hoof. For millennia, people have been harvesting willows and making pain relievers and fever reducers out of the bark. It was believed that the more bitter the willow, the better medicine it was. Except you got to what my father would call the point of diminishing returns, where it tasted so bad that you couldn't get it in your mouth. So then they had to find some of the sweeter willows to cut it with. And out on the prairie, milkweed. Milkweed was, again, a fiber plant. I keep reading this, the milkweed flower, when it has dew on the morning, people would take that and they would squeeze it into a pot and they would cook that down, and it made like a brown sugar substance. And it's really hard for me to understand how many milkweeds you'd have to squeeze in order to get something that you would actually be able to cook down. The pods were eaten, they were thrown in bison stews. It says there, 9 pounds of fluff equals one mattress. I also can't picture what 9 pounds of milkweed fluff looks like. You know, does it fill half this room? But back in World War II, it was discovered that the milkweed fluff made a good insulator. So a lot of the flight suits in World War II were insulated with milkweed fluff. And kids were given burlap bags and told to go out and pick milkweed pods, and they were given a quarter or 50 cents for a bag full of milkweed. Not only was it a good insulator, and those B-52s were not exactly what you'd call climate controlled, unless you mean the inside was the same temperature as the outside, but they were not only warmer in their milkweed fluff flight suits, but they were also more floatable in their milkweed fluff flight suits. So. The big orange strip on the bottom there is one of the milkweeds. Pleurisy root is one name for it, which tells you what it was used for medicinally. It's the only milkweed that does not have a milky sap. And what's its real name?
Butterflyweed.
Butterflyweed. And it really is butterflyweed. And the plant in the upper right is a relative of the milkweeds. It's called Indian hemp, and it's one of the dog banes. And that is a really important fiber plant. The mints over on the left-hand side. In the middle, we have wild bergamot. On the far left, we have lemon horse mint. And the bottom one is mountain mint, Virginia mountain mint. The mints traditionally have been used as medications for indigestion and stomach problems. You know, when you're feeling a little out of it, you'll have some mint tea, and that really fixes you up. And they're also used for various colds and coughs, bronchial symptoms. The strongest, they were also harvested for oils. Mm-hmm. And the strongest oil comes from the lemon horse mint. And it was also used, apparently that can raise a blister on people, the oil on that is so strong. But it was also used as a hair dressing by Native Americans. The one on the far right is called Queen of the Prairie. Fantastic, looks like cotton candy, doesn't bloom for very long, but it just really dresses up a prairie. It likes moist prairies. And that is the prairie source for aspirin, salicylic acid. And who have we got in the middle? Oh, we've got wild onion, and that was an important food plant. Goldenrod on the top left. There's one species of goldenrod that was used by the Americans after the Boston Tea Party. It was the leaves were used as a tea substitute. We don't have it growing here in the Midwest. One of the native Midwestern tribes believed in bathing the babies in a goldenrod bath to make sure that they would grow up with a sense of humor. And I say, let's have more of that. Thomas Edison believed that if we ever lost our sources of foreign rubber, if a war or anything shut down latex sources, that goldenrod had enough latex in it to be viable as a commercial substitute. And he actually did some hybridizing. Goldenrods like to hybridize anyhow. But he did some hybridizing and came up with 12-foot-tall goldenrods. And at one point, Henry Ford gave him a Model T Ford that had tires on it that were made out of goldenrod rubber. So apparently, it is doable, but maybe not in large quantities. People always ask me how Native Americans avoided getting bitten by mosquitoes, and I'm not sure that they did. But white sage on the bottom left was thrown into fires and sort of smudged to help keep the mosquitoes away. The middle plant is Coreopsis, beautiful, beautiful prairie plant. And one of the things, if you take that yellow flower and you, I'm trying to think if you boil it or not. I think you boil it. It turns the water red and makes a really nice beverage, apparently, from what I read. But also it is a beverage that you would drink if you were a pregnant woman and you wanted to ensure that you had a girl child. So, all right. Compass plant. On the right. It's called compass plant because the young groups of leaves, at any rate, orient themselves so that they face north and south. The pith in the upper third of the stem is a prairie chewing gum. And there's some interesting superstitions with this. There are some of the tribes out on the plains that would never camp anywhere near compass plant because they believed it drew lightning to the site. And there are some tribes that made sure that they camped near compass plant because it repelled lightning. So take your choice. Cardinal flower likes wet or kind of moist prairies. This is another one that was used in tattoos to keep away illnesses. Echinacea in the middle is one of our TV drugs that they try to sell us. My older sister, whenever she feels a cold coming, she goes and gets her echinacea, and she believes firmly that it helps her immune system. So did the Plains tribes. It was one of the most important plants in the Great Plains. They used it for distemper. They used it in horses. They used it to treat rattlesnake bites. They used it for a bunch of different pretty drastic cures. Interestingly enough, the echinacea comes from the Greek word for hedgehog, which kind of explains what that seed head looks like, and that was used as a hairbrush. And the liatris, or gay feather, or blazing star, has a root that tastes kind of carroty. And some of the Plains tribes would harvest it and then store it, you know, just like bananas. I like bananas when they're just able to peel them, and they're really green, and most people like to wait until the sugars develop. But when the root of the liatris ages for a while, the sugars develop, so it's a little bit sweeter. So we've seen a lot of edible and medicinal. We've talked about a little bit about construction materials.